Okay, and we're back with the second and final game of the night. It's going to be G3 Ego versus G3 Full Trust. I'm hype. Omnicracker, are you hype? All right, Omnicracker is obviously not here right at this moment.
Just
so,
kidding, my microphone was muted. I was so hype I forgot to unmute.
Fantastic, fantastic. So we are going to see our first... Not our first band come in here.
Leave all the OPs unbanned. Secret
absolutely.
Strat.
Secret strat. Leave all the OPs unbanned, and then they have to ban something. Then they have to give you something on first pick that they don't want to. I am hoping this is not a connection issue. I've had my fair share of those throughout the course of our league. Oh. We do see a Lulu ban.
It was planned.
And so we do see a Nidalee ban and a Lulu ban. Lulu just being a generally strong mid laner, I think, still, even with the Lichbane nerfs. And Nidalee, not really sure. I haven't seen, unfortunately, very many of Ego's games, so I'm not really sure what they play. I actually don't think I saw any of Full Trust games throughout the entire Spring League, which is odd. Heimerdinger ban as well. Heimerdinger, with a, what is it, the Spirit of the Spectral Wraith, actually provides quite a bit of objective control. See Master Li, or Master Yi and Kha'Zix banned as well, both very strong junglers in this in the current generation of the game. You have any predictions for how these picks are going to go down here, Omni?
Well, I think this first pick is going to be highly telling of what they want from their composition. Since they left a ban open, they clearly had something that they wanted to make sure didn't get banned, I guess. Thresh?
We do see a Thresh being picked up. There may have also been a penalty associated with a previous game played. I'll have to clarify with that on why we do have the ban out.
They might have just honestly left it.
We do see Ezreal being locked in almost immediately by Mystic Raw here. A solid, if not highly contested, AD carry right now. You see usually Lucian picked up for that same kind of mid-game objective fighting power that Ezreal is also used for. I think Lucian may actually do it a little bit better than Ezreal, although Ezreal suits some playstyles a little bit better.
Ezreal can play basically however you want to play him, is the benefit to him, and he's much, much safer, especially against the Thresh, being that he can get hooked and then E out, and if Thresh happens to follow on that hook and it's like max range, he'll go flying under his tower. Not good times for the Thresh. Bye, locked in.
You see a Renekton.
Bye, Ezreal.
And a Sion being hovered over.
I don't expect that Sion to go through, but it might.
It's,
I don't think so.
It's not unknown for Ego to pull out some very interesting, picks. In a few of their games, we've seen them. Them and Shadow Sanctuary are known for playing stuff that's a little bit, you know, off the meta. Maybe not exactly what you would always see picked.
Teemo.
So, but
his little face.
That Teemo being rotated too indicates to me that the Sion may in fact be a troll hover. And yes, we are going to see a Pantheon picked up. Pantheon, an absolutely fantastic early game pressure jungler. Whereas Vi can do some work with that Vault Breaker, but doesn't really become a threat until 6 when she has the Assault and Battery. The Teemo flash back as the counterplay. It's all about the strategy in picks and bans, making sure that everybody knows. Pick Teemo if you want to.
It's actually on PvE, they're nerfing Teemo because his global taunt is so strong, it's affecting champion selects just like this one. It's starting to become a massive problem where everybody's hovering Teemo. See, look, it's happening again.
And the re-counter of the Teemo hover.
This time, with Clarity Teleport, the ultimate troll Teemo hover.
Now, we do see Jax picked into Renekton. That's not usually a matchup that you want to pick for yourself. Jax does fare pretty rough against Renekton in the early game, not really hitting its power spike until about 20 minutes is when we start to see Jax get really strong. And Renekton kind of starts to fall off about 10 minutes after that in a typical game. So I'm not entirely certain about that pick, although they may just be looking to play for late game. Though in that case, I think you might pick a different AD carry. Very intrigued by these team comps.
It kind of tells me that they want their Jax to be able to be split pushing for days, because eventually he's going to outscale Renekton, but Bai is probably going to be mostly top lane focused, especially against, you know, Graves, Thresh, who has decent ability to escape from ganks. So Bai is probably going to be more looking towards the top and middle sides of the map. Katarina locked in there at the end against LeBlanc.
Against LeBlanc, Pantheon, Thresh, and Renekton can all interrupt her ultimate.
Now, that being said, Kat's more about the resets that she gets anyways than she is just about her ultimate. But if she is able to wait out the CC, wait out most of it, get in, you know, after the initiation, probably onto the back line, you know, somehow pick up LeBlanc, she's going to get a lot of damage a lot of fast and start picking up those resets. Graves is kind of tanky as far as AD carry goes with his passive stacking up to free armor and magic resist. So it's going to be kind of hard to blow him up. But with the amount of CC that they have in Jax stun and Alistar knockup and Vi in general, she's going to have a decent amount of time to get in there and do what she needs to do.
Yeah, and she's definitely going to be looking to pick up LeBlanc as everybody else on that team does. You know, as you said, Graves is an unusually tanky AD carry. He does not go down quite as easily to other AD carries, or as other AD carries do. We are seeing both lanes actually running double heal, so no exhaust on either side. And we do see a teleport from Renekton, obviously going to be looking to capitalize on that early game pressure that he can exert and push that pressure all over the map, whereas Jax is running the Ignite, so at level 6, probably going to have a little bit of a greater kill potential.
Now, that sets a precedent, too, where Jax has the combat summoner to combat Renekton, whereas Renekton has the teleport. So if he's able to kill Renekton early and get his snowball started, Renekton's not going to have the time in the lane that he should or that he wants to. If Renekton does fall behind to a Jax, it's not going to be looking good for him. So Pantheon might have to look to make his top gank very effective as well. Whether he starts there or mid is up to him, though, I guess.
Yeah, I
would almost gank Jax over Katarina. They're both so mobile and can get away so fast.
Yeah, I definitely think Ego is going to want to shut this game out within the first 35 minutes or so, as LeBlanc and Renekton do kind of start to fall behind their opponents as of that point, and the engage potential from a Vi-Alistar combo, that's a lot of time that they can keep you suppressed or popped up in the air or just in some other kind of way debilitated. It could be a very rough engage to go up against, even with the Thresh box to dissuade the remainder of the team from coming in to join.
But all of this team can jump right at you, though. Vi can jump right at you, Ezreal can shift right at you, Jax can jump right on top of you, Alistar can headbutt to you, and Katarina can Shunpo. All of them have the ability to move block that box. So slows aren't as important here. They're big on Jax and Vi, but the rest of the team doesn't really care about being slowed. They do care, however, about being hooked and flayed.
They absolutely care. Everybody cares about being hooked and flayed. I don't care who you are.
Yeah, it's not a good time.
It can definitely put you in some absolutely unfavorable situations, regardless of how strong you are. I've seen the tankiest of tanks go down to a bad positioning hook.
Yeah.
So I guess we'll see.
CC chain is all it takes.
Yeah, I guess we'll see how this... And there is definitely CC chains to be had on Ego. The hook into the stun, into the other stun, into a silence. You're not going to be doing very much. But I guess we'll see how everything shakes out as we get here into the second game of the night. We are back here in this game. G3 Ego versus G3 Full Trust. This is going to be a round 3 game, I believe it is. We've skipped ahead a few with some current playing games. We do see both teams now getting out here onto the field. Absolutely wasting no time in getting out there either. They are ready to fight.
Part 2.
Yeah, Invade Possibility Part 2, it does appear. It looks like Invade Guaranteed Part 2.
Nope.
Thresh did get spotted there. Hook comes down, does manage to land onto Vi. Vi taking a lot of damage there. Tries to flash out, gets rooted in place by the LeBlanc, and Vi's going to go down, losing a flash as well. Reactionary flashes to those early First Bloods are not always the best choice. As they do leave you down a summoner. And, oh, Alistair's going to walk in here. Does find the 5 again. They did come back in. Does use his pulverized flashes over the wall. Manages to make it out of there. But as I was saying, those reactionary flashes, maybe not always the best choice. Because it does give up your flash for a first blood kill that's honestly worth less than a standard kill that early on in the game.
Of course, if it saves you, it's perfectly fine as it did with Alistair there.
Absolutely. You see Ego, a couple people going back to buy and heal up, capitalize on that early first blood gold that they got. That first blood did go onto Thresh. Looks like he's going to dump a lot of that money into some vision and a ruby crystal.
Jungler's going to be starting on the bottom side of the map here. Like, their focus will be either top or mid lane. Top lane may be the focus after all is said and done, as there's already a little bit of trading going on.
Absolutely, ton of trading going on.
Putting the hurt down.
Yeah, Rankton got some pretty good trade-off on Jax, but Jax started out with that Counter-Strike, so he was able to pop it and get a stun off and force a trade back onto Rankton very effectively. Although Rankton has a... Oh, we do see Katarina coming in pretty hard onto... Oh, once again, here comes the Counter-Strike. Stun, Ignite ticking down. Both flashes blown.
Whereas land to the bottom lane. A little bit of fighting going on. Hook lands onto Ezreal, who just shifted, actually. That puts him in a little bit of trouble. Heal blown. Play backwards. A little bit of trading still going on, but the minions have arrived, and that's a lot of damage that they don't want to deal with. It's going to back off there.
A lot of early game fighting we're seeing here. Once again, we see Jax using that Counter-Strike very effectively, jumping in, getting the stun off on Rankton, picking up an extra auto attack off the back of it.
I think we're gonna see a bunch of this little scrapping all through the beginning of the game. It's top lane.
Oh!
Jax actually does get picked up. Wow. Good
and
slice and dice by Renekton.
Once Renekton hit three, he did have his full kit available, so he was able to counter that stun with another stun. Katarina drops a ward. Shun pose over to it to avoid any more damage from LeBlanc. But we did see. Oh, and once again, Ezreal does get hooked, does blow his heal, manages to make his way out of there.
Wow.
Great pulverize from Alistair to force the disengage. But this is going to be a lot of damage going on to that tower. Pantheon invading into the jungle does find Vi. Manages to pick up Vi.
Over, blocks the vault breaker. So
wow.
That way she couldn't have gotten away. Brilliant play. Able to pick her up with the kill. Refresh double buff. Katarina going a little bit aggressive on the LeBlanc. Good damage going back and forth. LeBlanc's forced to flash away. More face bashing top lane. Renekton's hit level 4, and Jax is still level 3, but Jax has a major health advantage right now.
Oh, once again, we see Katarina come in. Very hard. Wow.
That's how you go hard, ladies and gentlemen.
And that's the Assassin versus Assassin burst attempts that we expect to see around level 6 when they both have their full kits available to them. But they're not wasting any time here.
Katarina must have read my how to think, because she knew that and just did it beforehand when nobody would expect it. Bottom lane, fighting going on as Thresh flashes out from under tower range, lands a hook onto Alistair, brings him back into Graves. Graves shooting. Ezreal drops, the heals drop, Thresh is walking away, misses the Q. Ezreal's not going to pick up Thresh in the end, double kill for Graves.
Wow, and that was...
That was... Who's healed that time? I don't know, there's 4 heals in the bot lane, there's been like 2 or 3 heal baits.
Yeah,
that one worked out in the end.
Heal baits all over the place. Thresh left at incredibly low health, but did a very good job moving himself around to dodge that Q after Ezreal Mystic Shift back into the fight. Arcane shifted, sorry.
Wasn't able to pick it up, though, and that cost him dearly. If he had been able to pick up Thresh, he would have been able to have something back from that. However, since he was behind on CS and now he's lost a whole bunch to the tower, he's got a longsword to the BF sword of Graves. Huge disparity in items.
Absolutely massive.
I think it's safe to say that Graves is bigger.
Absolutely massive disparity in items. Disparity in items on the supports as well. You see an ancient coin and a sight stone built for Thresh, where it's just a relic shield and a ruby crystal on Alistair. As well as a couple other pocket wards for Thresh. Just to make sure he gets full ward coverage about.
Nice. You never know when you're going to have that, 7-minute in-lane period as a support. Get to lane at 6 minutes, don't leave until 14.
Yeah, that's definitely one of those times you're like, Jesus, I wish I had bought a couple more wards on my last back. I don't know if I really needed...
By that time, I'm wishing I bought regen.
Although we do see Pantheon coming in, does take the Thresh Express all the way in. Alistair trying to get out, but gets hooked back in. We're having to walk back through the smoke screen again. Walking through that smoke screen twice, not very fun. It does slow you down a little bit.
Very well executed gank there. He came through the Tri-Brush, which is pink warded. Just took the Thresh Express in. Katarina goes ham. If she can. Pops the passive of LeBlanc. They both walk away from that. Pantheon scares her out of the lane. Bottom lane, Vine is hanging around. She's at the white, but I don't know if she's really going to have any say in this lane. She's already 0-2. So she kind of needs the time up to farm up until 6. Before she's going to have any real impact. Graves about to have access to his ultimate. That's going to be a scary burst in that bottom lane.
Kind of read that bouncing blade to get a little bit harassed down. Renekton, we do see, has a 2-level advantage on Jax in the top lane. Puts down a stun, gets an auto attack, backs out of the way the counter-strike. Very large minion wave stacking up in favor of Renekton here. He is going to try and crash this into Jax's tower.
Yeah, that's going to be a nice little threat. It will afford Jax level 6, though. Where it really all begins for him. Now, by finally coming down through the river, no ward. So she will be getting into this bottom lane unseen. She goes. It's on to Graves.
Ballbreaker does land immediately, followed by the Assault and Battery. Here comes the Headbutt Pulverize on to Thresh. A little bit of a broken up. And, oh, there was a teleport by Renekton. Renekton comes in, swings the tide of this battle. Ezreal had flashed in. Does end up going down. Headbutt further into the tower. And it looks like Alistair's going to be safe. Unless he goes back in to engage this crocodile again. Does get flayed. Thresh does have the tower aggro. And he is able to hold it long enough for Renekton to pick up the kill under the tower. Very well played.
Pretty good job there, wasting a bunch of their time, though, under the tower, knowing that if Renekton had just come back, he would have died.
Oh, and Katarina is here. Vi does go in with the assault, or with the Vault Breaker, and that is a triple kill for Katarina as she shunpos, uses her Sinister Steel back and forth across the entire team over and over again.
Top lane Jax picks up Pantheon under the tower there. Flash is blurred by both of them. Katarina was held there, or they held them just long enough for Katarina to come down and get the triple, and that was pretty massive for her. She's got most of her Deathfire. Actually, she did finish her Deathfire Grasp, so that's pretty big.
Yeah, and that does put Katarina up by 200 gold on even the highest member of the opposing team, who is Graves. So, 4-0 Katarina, definitely very scary at 9 minutes.
Yeah, she just became a little bit of a force to be reckoned with.
Even with
It's up to her to continue the snowball.
Even with
Blanc can't really fight her anymore. She wants to roam.
Even with a gold disadvantage for her team, like I said, she is still ahead of the entire enemy team.
And with a strong Katarina, there's always a chance you can about any team fight. Good ward control in the bottom lane here.
Both teams doing a good job keeping vision on that dragon. Neither team wanting to give it up this early in the game. Not seeing a Feral Flare come out from either team this game. Bye-bye and a lot of longswords.
No Feral Flare? Is this League of Legends?
Oh, we do see another Counter-Strike engage by Jax. Does manage to get a lot of damage down onto Renekton. He does have that red buff, so getting a little bit of extra bonus damage every time he gets an auto attack off.
A little bit of a lull here, as both teams have felt each other out, and everybody knows that, whoa, Katarina, I say a little bit of a lull, but she just dives under the tower, she doesn't care.
And the pulverized headbutt going down onto Thresh. Thresh knocked into tower range, but the towers are already on the minions, and that's going to be a turret going down. Ezreal not able to capitalize on it. Just a phage in his inventory, going for a little bit of that survivability, feeling like he's behind, and that's a good feeling to have when you are behind. It's good to know your current strength and current weakness.
Alistair, still level 5, no access to his ultimate yet. Should have it soon. Probably after this wave.
You see a roam coming in from Katarina and Vi into the bot lane, but they are going to get spied out by a pink ward.
But he sees everybody. Hook
Vi does get hit by the hook. Ezreal is there as well. Gets flayed, gets hit by the box, manages to arcane shift out. Drops the True Shot Barrage, and it doesn't hit anyone but Graves, and doesn't really do a whole lot of damage. Here comes Pantheon. Both Ezreal and Katarina decide they are going to disengage from this. And LeBlanc shows up a little bit late to the party, but probably going to help take Dragon off of it.
And with top lane being pressured here by Renekton, actually, I say that, but Jax goes in onto him, gets counter-stunned, pops his ulti, and then walks away. Thought there was going to be a lot more coming.
Oh, here comes LeBlanc. She is able to get the double step forward. Shifts back, but now Katarina has free reign over her. Katarina uses the Death Lotus to pop the passive, but she's still pursuing. Uses Sinister Steel once again to get an extra speed boost, but not quite able to find... Oh! Actually is able to find LeBlanc, as LeBlanc walked into a warded bush.
LeBlanc was trying to be cute with the chains and turn a counter kill, but Katarina had the vision and it was enough to land the Shunpo, and that was all she wrote. Katarina's really big now, 6-0.
6-0, and we do see her finishing her magic penetration boots, picking up a pink ward, and probably go drop that somewhere in the river. Keep some permanent vision on stuff. At least permanent until your enemies can do anything about it.
Good zoning up here by Renekton, I've seen, under tower, making sure that if Jax wants any of the CS, he has to pay for it.
Oh, we do now see a two-man gank into by the bot lane onto Katarina. Graves manages to get out, picks up the shutdown. A lot of gold for Graves. Takes tower shot, but the 10 stacks of True Grit says he doesn't care.
Yeah, there's that tanky 80 carry coming in. Able to, with a hook, pick up a 500 bolt shutdown. He's pretty happy about that, I'd say. Katarina does finally fall. And she's right now the main hope for this team. It's not looking grim yet, but Katarina is definitely the dead one. Pantheon,
oh,
also.
Here comes Pantheon. Does manage to land a Grand Skyfall, but immediately gets pulverized into the air, and LeBlanc is just going to put some damage down and allow Pantheon to blow up Ezreal. Meanwhile, Vi goes down in the mid lane to the Braves Thresh combo, and another turret will fall in favor of Ego.
Two to zero in towers. Got a, I can do math. 7,000 gold lead.
7,000 gold.
Good start.
7,000 gold lead at 14 minutes on such an early game oriented team as well. Renekton, as we said, Renekton, LeBlanc, and Pantheon all being champions who do incredibly well in the early game. When they can just use their abilities to really capitalize on
Mike
controlling the game.
Is also used blown. Ignite goes down onto Renekton. He does get flash leap struck by the Jax under tower, and that's the end of it. Jax gonna get some return damage on this tower as Katarina comes up as well. Pantheon might not want to stay here. However, coming up in the river is Graves and Thresh. Are they going to be able to get up here and get up in time? They do turn onto Pantheon. Pantheon takes a lot of damage. Does not make his way, dies. Graves shows up. Massive damage. Katarina Shempo's out. Jax not so fortunate.
And we do see another engage by LeBlanc onto Alistar. Ethereal Chains immediately followed by the Mimic Ethereal Change. Sigil of Silence goes down, but no damage to follow it up and get the Silence off. Vi comes in, and LeBlanc just decides, you know what, she's not that dedicated to this kill.
Ooh, falling out of here. What Alistar was trying to do. It was bad, I'm sorry.
And this is just
pushing the tower is good.
Yeah, they... True Shot Barrage does come across, immediately followed up by an Assault Battery. Here comes Katarina onto Graves. Graves went very low. The shield from Thresh, not enough to save him. Heal popped as well by Thresh. But now it's going to be the return fight as Renekton does come in here. Katarina brought very low as well as Vi. The Lantern used for Vision. And Pantheon coming in as well. Picks up Katarina under the tower. Pulverized from Alistar. A little bit too far away from Pantheon to pick anything up. It's a 3v2 in favor of Ego right now as LeBlanc does put a lot of her damage down onto Alistar, who has his ultimate running, taking reduced damage. And pulverize onto Renekton as well. Renekton just trying to get that tower down.
I think Blues may have DC'd.
Yeah, that does look like it may have been a DC by LeBlanc. So we are going to see a short pause here.
That tower has like 10 health, not even kidding.
Which is probably why Renekton decided to stay dedicated to it despite the... Despite the impending doom falling all around him, getting knocked up into the air and just wailed on by Jax. Jax does have a Blade of the Ruin King, is doing a sizable amount of damage at this point in the game. Well, let's take a look over here at the gold now.
A little bit of a tear. All of a sudden, he's 5-2-1. So Jax and Katarina are really scary right now. Ezreal just finished his Trinity Force, and it's not early, but it's about on par for time. It's certainly no Bloodthirster Phantom Dancer that Graves has, but he's about as strong right now as you would expect him to be.
Yeah, and
he's a little far behind, but as long as he can do what he needs to, he'll be fine.
And we do see there is still a slight gold, well, a not insignificant gold lead in favor of Ego, but it's less than it was just about 5 minutes ago. They were up by 7k there, now only up by about 4.5, so we do see a 2.5k gold reclamation by Full Trust.
It was actually kind of funny because Katarina came up and got a 500 gold shutdown on Graves. So you shut me down, I shut you down. It was all part of the plan to feed herself more money.
That was that's what we call calculated.
Yes.
Now the gold, looking at the individual players' golds, we do see Graves is up by over 3k on Ezreal, and that's almost his entire team's gold lead right there. Katarina, though, is on the other side, up by about 2.5k over LeBlanc. And we do see that despite the early kills in favor of Renekton, that Jax and Renekton are nearly dead even. Only about a 15 gold difference, so one minion difference between the two of them. Support gold is actually pretty astonishing as well. It's about a 2.5k gold lead by Thresh, who has 13 of 19 kill participation, which is a pretty impressive
Thresh
number.
Has been a lot. Alistair's been caught a few times, I think it's safe to say. Part of the times it was trading himself as opposed to a teammate, which is fine because he's not really worth a lot of money. But at this point, due to positional errors, he's been put really far behind. He's only level 8. Whereas Thresh has two levels ahead of him at level 10. So he's really far behind. He doesn't have nearly as much gold. He hasn't participated in nearly any of the kills. Whereas all across the board, actually, the assists, there's many more assists than there are for full trust. Just none of their, all their kills are centered on Katarina and centered on Jax. Everything else is like 2 assists, 1 assist, 3 assists. That's it. That's all the kill participation for the team. That's a slightly scary precedent if none of the rest of the team is able to get money from these kills. Because if Katarina gets popped in a fight, if Jax gets caught out of position and popped in a fight, that's all she wrote. That's all their damage. All
right, and we are back in game here. You see Ezreal and Vi coming out of the base. For some reason, that's what direct the camera wants to show us. It's like Graves.
You know, more fascinating than the 10 health tower.
Yeah. And it looks like we might actually see another little bit of a lull coming in here as teams are recovering from that last fight. A few deaths on both sides. Looks like we might see people focusing on farming just a little bit more, possibly pushing the last of those outer towers, trying to get that map control back up. And we do see Pantheon going really hard into Jax. Jax brought down to about half health. He is hit by Pantheon's full damage combo.
And Pantheon hurts a little bit right now.
Incor goes down, everybody cheers, and it looks like Vi gets caught out. Gonna try and use the Vault Breaker to get out, and once again, Pantheon does not allow her to do that. Uses his jump stun to get next to her, and then on the other side of her while she's stunned. But that's okay.
Pretty good about that so far.
That's okay, because she's not really worth gold anymore at this point. 07 and 2.
He was just trying to get a ward down, trying to get some kind of jungle pressure. Ended up getting caught out.
Another pause coming in. Once again, going to go over the pause rule. One reminder, there is one pause from each team allowed, maximum 5 minutes. Any additional pauses used will result in loss of bans in subsequent games. Up to a maximum of once 3 bans are lost, that will be a forfeiture of the next game. But we do see LeBlanc maybe having some connection issues, so hopefully we can get those sorted out and get back to our game of League of Legends here, as both teams do appear to be grouping up towards the middle, maybe looking for their first big full 5-on-5 team fight here. So Ezreal's still farming the bot lane. Might not be part of it. So what do you think, Omnicracker? How does Full Trust get rest control of this game from Ego?
I think their best bet right now is to find a way to utilize Jax and Katarina to their full power. Since those are the only people with kills, they need those two in a fight, possibly a 2v2, possibly like a 3v3, with Ezreal in there as well. Maybe start getting Ezreal some kills. They need global objectives badly. Be that towers, dragons, I say barons, but that's not happening for a while. They need some form of global gold. however they can get it, as well as maybe one or two good team fights.
Oh, and once again, Alistair does get hit by the death sentence. He does come in, manages to get a pulverize on two people. Graves now knocked out of position, forced to use his flash, immediately attempting to get out of there. And we do see Katarina and Graves both go down. Ezreal's over here on the sidelines, picking up kills, but Renekton is rampaging through the lines, and that is a team fight that just went wildly in favor of Full Trust, and that was the fight they needed. This was a 4v5 situation. They were able to capitalize on it very well.
They were listening, and they heard me, and they won their team fight. It was a 3-for-4, so it was a close fight. LeBlanc is still DC'd, it seems, but in the 4v5 at Dragon, they were able to come out ahead. Hey, there we go. And that's going to potentially open up this tower as well. So good start on resting control back. Pantheon all beat.
Pantheon does come in, not quite in time to save the tower. Jax putting down a lot of damage. He is trying to focus his attention on Vi, trying to take Vi out of the fight. Jax decided to commit to a fight that he didn't realize Pantheon had backup coming, but is able to disengage himself from it.
Pantheon and crew show up and are a little too scary for the man drop. I mean, from the man drop.
See both teams kind of wandering in. Oh, once again, and another death sentence does go down, immediately followed up by a flay and a stun from Reddington. A lot of damage going down onto Katarina. She is brought down to about half health, but Alistair and Ezreal come in and just decide they're going to dissuade this fight. Though it is a 4v3 situation in favor of Ego right here. And they look to be possibly setting up for Baron? I don't think so. No, they have decided that is not what they want to do.
Rotational play. I think they want this top outer tower.
Walk here going down to the bot lane to push that, get that pushing out. You see Full Trust trying to collapse onto Ego as they do pull back to their outer tower. Thresh on the wrong side does manage to get himself onto Barret, uses the death sentence to get over the wall. Renekton using a very good stun to stop Katarina from doing some damage, but the DFG, immediately followed by the Death Lotus, does come out and pick him up as he tries to slice and dice over the wall.
Yeah, he stopped her from doing a whole bunch of damage, and then she just did the rest of it anyways.
And that's kind of Katarina's MO.
Yeah, and she does that.
This is going That does even the tower score back up. We now see only a 2.5k gold lead for Ego. Full Trust doing a very good job of maintaining control and getting back into this game using their two very fed late game carries to get their work done. Another death sentence comes into Alistair. And then Ezreal gets taken very low, does get hit by the box under tower, tries to flash out. Here comes a lot of damage in the middle of this team fight, forced to flash out from Pantheon, and Katarina able to pick up a kill, but does go down to LeBlanc for it, and that's a 2-for-3 in favor of Ego, which is not exactly what I expected. Graves goes in to bite this Jax. Jax maybe should have tried to not hide in the bush. Graves obviously knew he was there.
Well, he didn't have many other places to go, and, you know, might as well make that last ditch effort, right? He actually did a whole bunch of damage to Graves. Wasn't enough, but hey.
Graves able to just lifesteal it all back up, too.
Yep. 80 carries, what are you gonna do?
His wave back out. We see Vi down in the bot lane trying to pick up a little bit of farm as that wave crashes in against her tower. Trying to get herself back in this game. Working on a Randuin's Omen right now. Still only about a half an item behind Pantheon. Pantheon's got the Brutalizer over her, but he too is also working on his Randuin's Omen.
We're going to have a whole bunch of tank stats, a whole bunch of fast in this game.
You see Ezreal possibly working on a Bloodthirster now? do see a Vampiric Scepter in his inventory, but also a Longsword.
He may be going Blade of the Ruin King. I've seen a few Ezreals doing that recently. With that other Longsword in there, he might be building that into a Bilge Water.
Entirely possible.
It actually adds a significant amount of burst. And a little bit more kiting ability.
Ping's going down on the Thresh as he does clear out a ward, and Ping's on where they now know the pink ward to be. Graves going into the bot lane, possibly going to shove up solo. He does know three, possibly even four, of the members from Ruster on the top lane. Now he knows there are four people up there.
It's all about positioning at this point of the game, because it's about where the power turn is going to start happening. Any good team fights in one team's favor or another can completely turn. This is a very crucial time.
Red team's turret has been destroyed.
That is going to be Graves picking up another turret for his team. Just widening up that gold lead just a little bit. Assault and Battery does come down on the Thresh. Box goes down and Vi is brought very low under the turret. She got her ulti out. And that seems to be her only job at the moment. She's not really able to do a whole lot else. Bragton has Dominus going slicing and dicing through the enemy team. Katarina gets hooked under the tower, brought down as the play comes down as well. That's a double kill for LeBlanc. And now Alistair is just trying to disengage this fight. Does use Pulverize, does use Headbutt, goes down anyways. Ezreal forced to flash out, now running for his life as the Grand Skyfall comes in to cut him off. And he is forced to turn back into an enemy team that wants nothing but his blood. And that is an ace by Ego as Graves takes down an inhibitor in the bottom lane. That is an ace in a 4v5 situation. That is the power of an inner turret at 25 minutes. Can really help your team fight.
With Graves taking down the inhibitor there as well, that's a huge power play for Ego here, especially since it's bottom inhibitor, which means it's the farthest away from Baron Nashor. You're going to have a huge amount of time as soon as they wait for minions pushing the base to do Baron. At this point, Ultras needs to turtle up, get wards down around the Baron area, around their bottom side jungle, and just not get caught. They need to get that good team fight that they have and have gotten before. They need to get another one right here.
Does look like Fultrust has actually decided that they're going to try and rush the Baron. No, the only one to engage was Jax. The rest of his team did not seem to be on board with that. Although they would have maybe not have had the damage to do it fast enough. But it would have been a very admirable attempt since they did know that members of Ego were going back to buy in this scenario.
It's the Jax syndrome. You always think you can solo Baron.
And most of the time you're right.
Well, I mean, yeah. This is Jax after all.
That sense comes down, does not find anything. Flay manages to slow Jax down. Ethereal Chains rooted into place for a second with no follow-up.
A little bit of a tense moment here. Nobody wants to throw.
Yeah, they're both in situations where this is kind of teetering on the edge of a knife. They're allowing Vi to farm up those super minion waves, letting her try and get caught back up and get back into this game at 0-8. Ezreal does get hit by the Death Sentence. A lot of damage going down onto him. Ethereal Chains is going to land down onto Alistair. Alistair tanking a lot of damage up, not burning his ultimate yet. We do see a teleport coming in from Rington. And Jax sees it, flashes out from his fight with Graves. It's now a 2v1 situation. Once again, Death Sentence does land onto Alistair. Alistair goes down immediately after the Deathfire Grasp hits him. But that's going to be Katarina picking up a shutdown onto LeBlanc. And Katarina's still fighting. Oh, Jax is very low. Brankton has come back down to try and join this fight. But now he is in a 1v3 situation. Vi does engage onto him. He does pop Dominus. He's putting a lot of damage down onto Katarina, chasing her out of the fight, not allowing her to do any of that sustained damage as Pantheon's Grand Skyfall comes in and splits the team up. Graves able to pick up the tower and comes down, pick up a kill onto Katarina, makes a couple tower shots, and then walks away.
And a Nexus tower falls as well to the minions in the bottom lane.
Brankton takes
falling down everywhere.
Rankton takes four tower shots there. It looks like Graves is going to pick up this top inhibitor turret as well. Vi coming in. Decides she wants to fight Graves. Graves decides he doesn't want to fight her.
Graves is like, no, I'm okay, thanks. I'm the outlaw. You weren't supposed to catch me. He's had a few run-ins with the law before. He knows how it goes.
Thresh now on a desperate runaway from Jax and crew. Ballbreaker comes in. Used to put some damage down onto the minion wave. Jax still going after this Thresh, though.
Like, man, I bet you he wishes he had a real weapon right now. He'd be able to jump farther and do more damage. But, I mean, he's got a Blade of the Ruined King. I don't see why he doesn't use that instead.
Quant goes in, finds a member of five. Well, I mean, if you had a stick with nails in it too, would you use anything else?
Well, I mean, it depends. I mean, this guy's, you know, got a huge shield and a spear and a bunch of armor. I might use something else against him. Or the alligator.
I don't know.
Maybe not the cowboy with an attitude problem, but...
Stick with nails in it, though, man. Have you seen the crit range on that thing? It's huge.
That's true.
Sweeping Lens does come down to clear out the ward that they did see LeBlanc place as she almost face checked into four. And looks like Ego's going to try and take this Baron. Also looks like Voltrust is not going to make it easy for them. Putting down some harass from the outside. Fresh doing a very good job of zoning, but the True Shot Barrage does come over. Blue team does manage to pick up the Baron, and there is a huge fight going on in the Baron pit. Katarina allowed to full channel her ult, but then gets stunned at the very end of it. Vi actually managing to pick up a kill there, it looks like, but that's going to be a triple kill for Graves, and now the only one left. That is a quadra kill, and it's a penta kill for Graves. Absolutely fantastic play by Ego. Good control through that entire fight. Even though Katarina was able to get a full channel down, it just wasn't enough. That's going to be a surrender by Full Trust. Very well played by Ego to exert some early game champions into mid game control. Great fights all around. GG to both teams.
They held it back there for a little while. Katarina.